Ashet Audio presents The Discomfort Zone, How to Get What You Want by Living Fearlessly, written by Farrah Storr and read by the author. Prologue. Introducing the Brief Moments of Discomfort Method. Have you ever had the sense of being stared at? I have, by 25 different pairs of eyes, all at once. It was my first day on the job as editor-in-chief of Cosmopolitan magazine, and my new office was a glass box, 12 feet by 12 feet, slap bang in the middle of the office floor. It had one window that looked down on the streets of Soho below, an old navy blue leather sofa in one corner, graciously left behind by the former beloved editor, and three glass walls that looked out over 25 desks, behind which sat my new team. Except on that summer morning in 2015, I wasn't quite sure they wanted me there. And the truth was, I wasn't quite sure I wanted to be there either. Just a few weeks earlier, I'd been editing a much smaller magazine in the same building. It had been my first editorship, and the magazine, a health title called, rather unoriginally, Women's Health, was one I had grown to love. I had launched it 3 years earlier, from an airless back room with just two members of staff and an almost non-existent budget. The hours were long, the pay was bad, and we'd had just 8 weeks in which to get an issue together from scratch. Oh, and we had to sell 100,000 copies from issue one. And if we hadn't, well then the magazine would have folded, along with all the other women's magazines toppling around us like dominoes, and we'd all be out of jobs. I took the gamble regardless. After all, how hard could it be? 3 weeks into that job, and hard didn't even cover it. Celebrities wouldn't speak to us. Women's what? The agents drawled down the phone. Writers wouldn't write for us. I've never heard of this magazine in my life. Sounds like a vitamin supplement. And even I was doubtful that we'd get it off the ground in time. And yet, along the way, something miraculous happened. The obstacles that I'd worried would trip us up, lack of money, lack of people power, lack of time, were the very things that made us soar. Our lack of resources forced us to be wildly inventive. We hustled with a ferociousness only the desperate can truly understand. And to all those picture agencies, model agencies, and celebrity agents out there, please forgive us our trespasses. We literally knew not what we did. We were irreverent and bold in a way only the stupid or the damned can be. We experimented with new writers, new photographers, and came up with inventive, in other words, cheap, ways to illustrate our stories. Because the truth was, we couldn't afford to be conventional. Convention was expensive. We held our breath when the first issue went on sale on the 4th of January 2012. Within 24 hours, the sales figures started to trickle in. Then the emails. Then the congratulatory messages from advertisers who loved the product. It was exciting. It was naughty. It was funny in a way that health magazines had never been before. By the end of the month, we'd sold 103,000 copies. That number went up and up as the months went by. Awards started to gather. By the end of the year, we were, to our absolute disbelief, hailed as the most successful women's magazine launch of the decade. By the summer of 2015, I'd been editing Women's Health for exactly 3 years and 8 months. We had grown into a team of 12, who were as tight and as close to a work family as I had ever known. I knew my colleagues' families, and they knew mine. One of them even drove me 200 miles to pick up my puppy during the coldest, snowiest winter to hit Britain in 25 years. Things finally felt comfortable. And then I got the call to go and edit Cosmopolitan. Now, if this were a film, this is the point at which this scene would pause while I give you some qualifying backstory as to why this was not the idyllic scenario it at first appears. Cosmo was struggling. Its readership numbers were dwindling. I opened the magazine and found very little had changed since first reading it 20 years earlier. There were still agony ants in it, the same one, in fact, that I had been taking advice from about what to do with a flaccid penis back in 1990. There were still articles on 10 ways to give blowjobs. I mean, seriously, was anyone even giving them in 2015? And a deeply uncomfortable-looking naked male centrefold who turned out to be some guy who came fifth in The Apprentice. It was still a great magazine, no doubt, but it also needed turning around, and quickly. The thing was, I didn't know if I was the person who could do that. Firstly, I would be replacing one of the best and most adored editors in the business, a woman who I'd looked up to my entire career, but one I knew the team loved like their own mother. To make a real change, I'd also need to do something radical. And to do that, I'd get people's backs up from day one. Everyone from the team to the hundreds of thousands of loyal Cosmo readers across the globe. Cosmopolitan was the biggest female media brand in the world. I didn't want to be the one who dug its grave. And yet, 48 hours later, I decided to take the job. Why? Because I needed to be pushed. I needed to feel the same frisson of nerves and tension that had characterised my first few months at Women's Health. I needed to be pushed into my discomfort zone. And so there I was, on my first official day in the office, alone in my glass cube. Only a few boxes had arrived from my previous office, the rest somehow lost in transit along with, inexplicably, my desk. The only thing that had made the short journey from my old office at Women's Health to my new office at Cosmo was an enormous, comedic stand-up desk, and I was wearing 6-inch heels. I stood behind it, my feet sore, my back aching, and looked out. I felt ridiculous. Ridiculous and scared out of my mind. You see, my brain did not see the 25 members of the Cosmopolitan team outside my door as individuals, but rather as one giant, hostile mass. Every one of them, my brain told me, didn't want me there. Every one of them wanted me to fail. But it's a funny thing, the human brain. It lies. It looks for easy absolutes to create a scary narrative. A narrative that, if you're not careful, will paralyse you. I had discovered this a few weeks previously when taking a short break before joining the magazine. The hotel I was staying at had an outdoor pool. It was a beautiful emerald green thing, as still and pretty as a Monet lily pond, and every morning I vowed to swim in it. There was just one issue. It was freezing, properly bone-rattlingly cold. Still, every morning I would rise at the crack of dawn, head down despite being bleary with sleep, slip off my robe and get as far as the edge of the pool. I would then dip my forefinger in with all the slow deliberation of Nigella Lawson lowering her index finger into a bowl of buttercream, retract it and then head back to the hotel. By day three, I had not completed a single lap. The problem, I realised, was that my brain was viewing the pool as one giant ice block, registering it as one long, continuous struggle. Of course I knew that wasn't true. After all, there are about 5 other people in there every morning. Sure, there would be a moment of internal struggle as I decided whether to change into my swimming costume. Then there would be a small amount of discomfort as I first stepped into the pool. And then it would be crunch time, the nasty moment of true discomfort when I had to submerge my entire body into the water. But once that was done, that would be it. On my final day, I went to my suitcase, pulled my swimsuit on without even thinking, and walked purposefully down to the pool. I sat on the edge and dipped my foot in. It was Arctic. Still, I gritted my teeth and slid in until half of my body was submerged. That was the horrid part, the crunch point, hanging there, suspended between the searing cold water that encased my legs and hips, while the rest of my body was open to the warm sun. Ordinarily, I would stand like that for some minutes, struggling. I would prolong the pain as my brain flitted between two courses of action, easy way out or hard way in. But here's the thing. The idea that leaving the pool was an easy way out was not strictly true. It was a trick conjured up by my brain. Leaving the pool at that crunch point would have been just as uncomfortable as ploughing my entire body under the water. It would have involved pulling myself out of the pool, exposing my wet body to the air, while, let's not forget, embarrassing myself in front of my audience of 4 floating pensioners. The hard way in, on the other hand, meant a brief moment of shock as my body was swallowed up by the freezing water. And so that's what I did. I counted to 3, held my breath, and descended into the discomfort. I don't remember the exact length of time it took before my teeth stopped chattering, but it would have been mere seconds. The pain was intense, yes, but fleeting. So quick, in fact, that I barely remembered it once I started to swim. Instead, I only remember the sun on the surface of the water, the waiter who placed a drink by my sun lounger, and the fact that I felt relaxed and triumphant for the first time in months. And so, on that first morning at Cosmopolitan, I thought back to that brief moment of discomfort in the pool. Armed with that knowledge, I told myself that there would be only short periods of pain. The entire day, week, month would not, as I had initially thought, be one long, drawn-out drama. Of course there would be discomfort as I told the office my radical plans for the magazine, but it would only last those few seconds as everyone clamoured in my office, not for the entire conversation. And sure, there would be some discomfort when I told certain members of the team that their work would need some tinkering, but the pain would only last the few minutes it took me to explain. Without exception, discomfort is never as bad as we think it will be. It also never lasts as long as we think it will. Because here is what I have learnt. Discomfort is not a constant. It is fleeting. Neither is discomfort debilitating. On the contrary, it is empowering. However, it has taken me years to realise this. Years of being thrown into deeply uncomfortable situations time and again, often through no choice of my own, in order to figure this out. I have moved to the other side of the world for a disastrous job, more of which later, have inadvertently found myself on a stage in front of 20,000 people, completely unprepared as what to say, the stuff of genuine nightmares, and been moments away from being sacked from my first job in journalism. But had I not unwillingly found myself in these difficult situations, I would not willingly throw myself into similar scenarios in the manner in which I do today. Because facing true discomfort not only helped unlock who I was, but more crucially, helped unlock who and what I had the capacity to become. Getting comfortable with being uncomfortable is the mantra I now subscribe to. And you will too, once you realise how doing so has the power to unleash your true potential. Remember when you were growing up and your parents were always crowing on about how you weren't reaching your full potential, and you were like, what is this thing called potential? And how do I know when I've reached it? Well, stepping into your discomfort zone is the quickest way to find out. And by the way, if this all sounds like hard work for life's most hardened masochists, full disclosure time. I'm not tougher than your average woman. I've also not benefited from any extraordinary childhood that would prepare me for living this sort of life. In fact, I'm not tough at all. I was the kid who screamed at the nursery school gates when a mother kissed her goodbye. I'm the person who could, if allowed, spend all night locked in the toilet cubicle at a public function. I'm the person who, when asked to give a few impromptu words in front of a crowd, feels as though her sphincter muscle is about to give way. Or at least I was that person, before I got comfortable with the uncomfortable. Now, I can breeze through all of it without having a cardiac arrest midway. Better than that, I enjoy these situations, and you have my absolute word. Once you discover the ease with which anyone can appreciate discomfort, you will too. The BMD method. Momentary. That's what all pain and discomfort is. You know those little wax strips that you pat onto your moustache and rogue chin hairs? Men, close your ears and shut down all visual imagery now, please. That's what discomfort is. Teeny, tiny little frissons of pain that pass almost instantaneously. When you give a public speech, the only bit that's really uncomfortable is the part just before you walk on stage. Okay, or maybe the first 3 seconds as you look out at all those faces staring back at you. But after that, it's fine. You're in motion. You don't have time to register pain or difficulty. Your brain is too busy working on the situation in hand. I'll give you another example. You know when a well-meaning colleague comes round with cake and you're 30 minutes into some bizarre newfangled deprivation diet? Well, your crunch point, and by that I'm referring to the most uncomfortable point in your teeny tiny moment of discomfort, is that second when your mouth is salivating. The cake is in your direct eye line, and you must either shake or nod your head to confirm or deny access. Once you've made that decision and the cake has left the premises, it's easy. Your brain moves on to something else. I call these BMDs, brief moments of discomfort. Anyone, and I mean anyone, can charge through short periods of change and pain. After all, most of us already do it every single day of our lives. We just don't willingly do it. I bet you've already had several BMDs today. Saying no to another drink after work, say, even though you desperately want one. Or having a confrontation with the difficult receptionist at your gym. These are all BMDs. The difference is, they were imposed on you, rather than you imposing them on yourself. What's the difference? Well, the difference is huge. When uncomfortable situations are thrust upon us, we have no control. And not having control can lead to alarming consequences. But uncomfortable situations that you have imposed upon yourself give you the opportunity to go into them with a plan. And having a roadmap when you find you've drifted far out of your comfort zone and into the choppy waters of your discomfort zone is what leads to magical outcomes. The BMD method is something I've been using for the past 5 years of my life. And since following it, not only have I transformed the way I live my life, but also the quality of the life I live. I take more risks because I am no longer paralysed with fear about the outcome of those risks. And by taking those seemingly uncomfortable risks, new, unthinkable opportunities have opened up for me. I'll give you an example. A big part of my job is now public speaking across the world, something I would never have believed could be an option for me. And it wouldn't have, unless I had put myself into my discomfort zone to begin with. So what is the BMD method, and how will it change your life? It's simple. The BMD method is a formula that anyone can use for any seemingly difficult situation. It's not complex, and it doesn't take time to remember. It's nothing more than a three-point plan that you can use during any time or situation when you feel you're out of your comfort zone. You can use the BMD method for life, although the more I use it, the less I need it. That's because once you start to use it, you will, as if by magic, get stronger, more confident, and feel more in control of your life. I know these sound like big, lofty promises that a man on a stage with a head mic and his hands pressed together in pyramid pose might throw at you, but this is real. I promise. Step 1. Acknowledge your fear. In many ways, this is the hardest bit, because it requires a smidgen of honesty on your part. This is the part where you stop pretending that you can conquer the world, because if you can, how come you haven't already? And acknowledge what scares you. It involves you identifying where your comfort zone ends and your discomfort zone begins. This is crucial because simply finding yourself in, or indeed being thrown into, your discomfort zone can be hugely traumatic. You feel out of control, so you make quick, often erroneous and risky decisions. And if you're traumatised, then you're unlikely to ever repeat the experience again. Though, as you'll see from Chapter 3, there can be some positive outcomes from traumatic situations, but we'll get onto that. Through the BMD method, you will not only be able to identify the exact moment in which you step into your discomfort zone, but you will also understand all the associated feelings you experience when you're there: racing heart, sweaty palms, undulating intestinal movement. Yeah, I know. But it's absolutely crucial that you identify, acknowledge, and understand these physiological reactions, because that's the first step in helping you control them. Step 2. Identify your moments of discomfort. If step 1 was about helping you to move into your discomfort zone, then step 2 is about making you feel, ironically enough, comfortable once you're there. There are two types of comfort. First, there is deadly comfort. Deadly comfort is the sort that has people rotting in dead-end jobs and comatose relationships. Deadly comfort is like those animal onesies we all thought were a good idea to wear sloping around the house in 2012 until we found our bodies beneath all that synthetic animal fur were starting to resemble said animal. I gained an entire dress size. That's what deadly comfort does for you. Deadly comfort requires zero thought, zero discipline, and will ultimately give you zero gains. Active comfort, however, is a whole different ballgame. This is a positive state of being rather than a lazy state of mind. Active comfort means feeling comfortable in an uncomfortable situation. And who wouldn't want that? The BMD method will teach you how to identify the three main brief moments of discomfort in any situation. It's unusual, by the way, for there to be more than this. Again, we'll get onto that. And solutions on how to get through them. These solutions are your BMD arsenal and can be anything from having a 4-second silence before you start a speech in order to get people's attention, works like a dream by the way, to have a line prepared should you not be able to answer a question in a job interview. Me? I always say, I can't answer that for you at the minute, but I can give you, then insert diversionary piece of information here so you are at least saying something. Having a BMD arsenal is key to making you feel comfortable in any unknowable situation. Step 3. Reimagining discomfort. This is the fun bit where you start imagining all the things you could do with your life because you have sussed out what discomfort actually is. Essentially, in step 3, you recognise that discomfort is little more than a few nanoseconds of feeling uncomfortable. You start to see that discomfort is not disruptive, but constructive. You begin to understand that it is not oppressive, but uplifting. And you see, finally, through the clearing mist, that discomfort is not about difficult struggle, but about invigorating challenge. Basically, what you will find by adopting the BMD method is that nothing in life is an insurmountable challenge, but rather a series of small, uncomfortable tests that can easily be overcome. The most difficult situations are not, as our brains lead us to believe, huge, terrifying experiences, but brief moments of pain that pass within seconds. I like to think of them as high-intensity interval training for your life. Once you understand the bite-sized nature of your fear, you'll be able to take on anything. In time, you'll even begin to enjoy these moments. This is now how I approach everything in my life. Big speeches I'm asked to give, confrontations I have to endure, parties I have to attend where I won't know a single person. Understanding that everything I fear can be broken down into three simple crunch points has allowed me to take on challenges I would ordinarily sidestep or approach with stomach-churning dread. You can't escape discomfort. In fact, those very situations where we feel alarmingly out of our depth are crucial for progression and success. But if you understand the secret of how to break through them, you can take on challenges you never thought possible and achieve astonishing success along the way. The miracle of stress. In 2008, the world felt like it was falling to pieces. Lehman Brothers, one of the world's largest global banks, had just filed for bankruptcy. A few months later, one of the US's largest insurance companies, AIG, did the same. The financial world was unravelling at its seams and taking with it the world's jobs, homes, and minds. We turned on the news and footage alternated between images of blank-eyed bankers being handed out of their offices for crimes many of us did not yet quite understand. The whole subprime mortgage CDO catastrophe is still difficult to get your head around, and American families being evicted from their homes. I will personally never forget seeing an entire family, complete with three dogs and twice as many children, vacating their large Spanish-style villa in Florida, and then pointing to the family station wagon, explaining this was now home for the foreseeable future. Of course, we now know that 2008 was the height of what has become known as the financial crisis, the most devastating global recession to hit the world since the Great Depression of the 1930s. At the time, however, few of us understood quite how serious the ramifications of dirty dealings by banks and bankers were, apart from the bankers themselves. This is perhaps why Dr. Alia Crum, an assistant professor of psychology at Stanford University, and Sean Acor, a positive psychologist and author of the excellent The Happiness Advantage, paid a visit to UBS Bank to undertake a study on the effects of stress. In 2008, the Swiss bank was not in a good way. Not only were there massive restructurings going on across the company, but the FBI had just begun a large-scale investigation into an alleged tax evasion scheme. This was on top of the fact that banks were collapsing around them like sandcastles in the tide. One can only imagine then that UBS bankers were less than thrilled to be the subjects of Crum and Acor's stress test. Taking a sample of 400 bankers, Crum and Acor split the largely male participants into three groups. The first group was taken into a room and made to watch a video that depicted stress as toxic and corrosive, a danger to both health and well-being. The second group, meanwhile, was shown a video with a very different angle. Stress was depicted as a performance enhancer. The third group was not forced to watch any clip at all and probably wondered what the hell was going on. A week later, the three groups were reassembled. Each was then asked to report on how they had felt and performed at work after having watched the video clips. The group who had watched the toxic video on stress and the group who had watched no video at all reported no changes. However, the group who had sat through the clip depicting stress as a performance enhancer reported the following: greater focus and higher engagement at work, as well as fewer health problems than before. Other experiments have demonstrated similar findings. A famous study on rats has shown that when these poor rodents are put under short periods of uncomfortable stress, in this case being confined to small cages for short periods of time, their brain cells were shown to enlarge temporarily. Meanwhile, in his tremendous book Bounce, Matthew Saeed found that it's not only the human mind, but also the human body that responds positively to controlled amounts of discomfort. Ultramarathon runners, who have endured years of grueling, often deeply uncomfortable ultra runs, have enlarged hearts as a result. Professional dancers, who must contort their bodies into the most agonising forms and shapes over years of practice, are rewarded with almost superhuman physiological abilities, feet that can turn at extraordinary angles, which surely all superheroes could do with. Professional pianists, similarly, have fingers that can flex and move far beyond the capabilities of mere mortals, a result of hours of challenging practice. Interestingly, the parts of their brains responsible for all that finger contortion is also shown to be significantly larger than your average Joe's. There is even some thinking to suggest that Brazil consistently produces the world's best football players. Pelé, Ronaldinho, Ronaldo, the list goes on, due to the fact that young Brazilians learn to play football, not with a light leather football on a soft grass pitch as we do across most of the world, but by playing futsal. Futsal is difficult. It is uncomfortable, especially when played with bare feet, as most young Brazilian kids do. It is also a fast-paced game, played on a hard surface, with a smaller goal area, and with a ball that is firmer, heavier, and has 30% less bounce than your average football. That means the game requires more dexterity, greater creativity, and greater skill at shooting. In other words, every time a child agrees to play a game of futsal, they are throwing their bodies and minds into the discomfort zone. The result? Brazil has won more World Cup titles than any country on earth. So you see, discomfort and its associated stress is not always the enemy we have been led to believe it is. If harnessed correctly, it can have enormous advantages and effects. From pro athletes to young kids on a dusty futsal pitch, a certain degree of stress is a difference between excellent and exceptional. Of course, that's an unpopular view to espouse. And as the former editor of a health magazine, I'm sure you can imagine how well this idea goes down. We live in an era of stress. Everyone is stressed. Ask anyone how their week was, and the ensuing answer is likely to produce the word stress at some point. Studies tell us that young people are more stressed than older people. Women are more stressed than men. And if you live in the UK and are a young woman, aged between 18 and 24, you're probably the most stressed out of all right now. But what if we've been treating the discomfort of stress all wrong? We have, after all, built an entire industry around protecting ourselves from it, rather than facing it head on. Over the last 25 years, we have institutionalised stress, pathologised it, packaged it up and put a blue ribbon round it, then sold it back to ourselves as luxury retreats with zero Wi-Fi and massages with stress-relieving juju powers. Every challenge we face, every obstacle that stands in our way, we slap a diagnostic label on it. And that label is stress. And what has happened is this. We have become terrified of stress. It is toxic. It will massacre your brain cells. It will lacerate your immune system. It will make your heart beat like a tribesman drum and pickle your internal organs in cortisol. Your blood pressure will be dizzyingly high. Your hair will thin and grey. Stress will pin its thumb down on your body and mind, leaving you wizened and cracked like a piece of gum on the pavement. And yet we have created a culture in which we insulate ourselves from anything we perceive as harmful or stress-inducing. It's the reason why schools are still dishing out medals for first, second, and last. It's the same reason that children's homework is no longer marked in malignant red pen, but in pink, because red pen is seen as too damaging and too indicative of failure. In our universities, we have seen the dawn of these strange new places, known only as safe spaces, a coddled zone, free from noxious talk, dissenting viewpoints, and basically anything that doesn't concur with our worldview. There have been a boom in stress-relieving colouring books for adults, while employers such as Nike and Uber now offer employees nap time to help ease office tensions. If that's not enough to eviscerate your stress woes, then perhaps the Googleification of offices around the land can help, where managers have substituted cold, corporate desks for chilled-out beanbag zones, evicted scary meeting room tables in favour of ping-pong ones, and ditched perfectly good internal staircases for giant slides so that stressed-out, grown men in polyester suits can come tumbling down like massive toddlers with canines. Oh, and if work can't help you eradicate all that nasty stress, then the lifestyle holiday sector can help. Simply let them whiz you up a stress-free break on which phones are taken from you like toys sequestered from naughty children, and extracurricular activities include tug-of-war, apple bobbing, and evening sing-alongs. This, by the way, is certifiably true and can be found along the east coast of America servicing frazzled New Yorkers. But what if we have got it all wrong? What if a little bit of the right sort of stress is exactly what we need? Because here is the thing. The human body is made to strive. It can, in fact, perform better under certain stressful conditions. It can not only survive discomfort, but soar within its confines. Remember back when we were all doodling in caves, throwing woolly mammoth steaks on the barbecue and wearing bones like a Tiffany pendant? We were also on high alert most of the time. This was the environment in which we and our ancestors before that developed. Life was hard. Discomfort was the norm. We were hunter-gatherers living in a world where we regularly experienced food shortages, swings in temperature, and attack from animals five times our size. We had to tough it out to find food and strive to keep warm and out of harm's way. We lived like this for thousands of years, and as such, evolution has paid us back by creating a human mind and body primed to experience daily stress and discomfort. But modern life has slowly taken away these stressors. We call this progress. In the Western world, there are now restaurants open 24 hours a day. You can buy your meals pre-chopped, pre-cooked, and pre-digested. Seriously, this exists. And then get them delivered to your front door with a click of your computer. We have aircon for when it's too hot, and central heating for when it's too cold. Small, benign-looking robots, Google's Echo, Amazon's Alexa, Apple's HomePod, now share our homes. They sit on our kitchen counters and bedside tables, waiting to be shouted at. Alexa, change the radio station. OK, Google, how many grams of sugar do I need to make a lemon meringue pie? I am waiting for the day someone brings out an AI machine that can empty your bladder. Here's hoping. The point is, progress has limited us as much as it has advanced us. We have become so smart at reducing stress that it is literally killing us. We are now faced with some of the greatest health challenges of our time. Obesity, diabetes, hypertension, and inflammation, all of them byproducts of insulating ourselves from the sort of stress our bodies and minds were designed to withstand. This book is a call for something some of you may find challenging to accept, that we need to embrace discomfort, not shield ourselves away from it. We need to make it part of our everyday lives. We need to throw ourselves into it in order to stretch and test our capabilities. We need it in order to feel truly alive. Successful people know and understand this. Show me a successful person who said the ride to success meant never stepping outside their comfort zone, and I'll show you someone who isn't quite as successful as they think they are. Our most revered leaders, athletes, and politicians spend much of their lives living within their discomfort zone. Stephen King, Oprah Winfrey, J.K. Rowling, Jay-Z, these are all people whose true success began when they were forced into uncomfortable situations. Oprah was fired from her first job. King's and J.K. Rowling's work was rejected multiple times at the beginning of their careers, while former drug dealer Jay-Z had to start his own record label after no one else would take him on. It was a brush with discomfort that led each one of them to recognise the magical, life-enhancing alchemy that happened as a result. You learn more in failure than you ever do in success, Jay-Z has said since, and amen to that. In this book, I have spoken to leaders, gold medal-winning athletes, and regular men and women who excel at life. Their skills are great, sure, but their true secret is how they approach discomfort. Everyone, from the 26-year-old dropout who changed the way the modern world dates, to the award-winning female firefighter who has saved dozens of lives, will tell you how they step into their discomfort zone day in, day out, and at the remarkable results that have followed. Taking on board their lessons, as well as adopting the BMD method, will not only result in helping you make better decisions and braver choices, but will ultimately bring greater meaning and happiness to your life. Learning how to step into your discomfort zone and feel comfortable is the revolution you have been waiting for. You just didn't know it yet. Chapter 1. Reframing discomfort. Getting comfortable with the uncomfortable. How comfortable do you feel when adrenaline strikes? Are you ready for it, like an athlete on the starting line? Or do you shrink away, lock yourself in a toilet until the moment passes, and then vow you'll never come face to face with it again? Or maybe, just maybe, you are the sort of person who is so catatonically afraid of that heart-throbbing, stomach-clenching feeling that you try and avoid all situations in which you know it will hit. Growing up, I was a sprinter. I had legs that spun like a Catherine wheel and could outrun any boy in class. I won every sports cup going, on Tuesdays and Thursday evenings, would drag my poor, overworked mother down to the local athletics track to watch me practice. Practice was a breeze. Out there on the track, crouched on the starting line like a squirrel, I had no expectations other than I would beat my last documented time. I could do 100 metres in 14.2 seconds. Not bad for a 12-year-old who still hadn't figured out how to change the loo roll back home. I was in my element. I had what my coach called potential. Lots and lots of potential. There were whispers of being good enough to run for my county. And after that, who knew? Maybe even trying out for the national team. I would lie awake in bed at night and imagine myself resplendent in red, white and blue lycra on the winner's podium, cradling my gold medal before shuffling off to be interviewed by Brendan Foster. There was just one problem. I couldn't perform at competition level. The issues would start the night before, with a dry throat and a stomach that felt like Mike Tyson's fist was clenched around it. By the morning of the competition, I was at my worst. I would get up, feel faint, and then look in the mirror to see I was the colour of a spirulina smoothie. By the time we arrived at the running track, and I'd seen.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.